Yeah, viewers. One word to capture the spirit of Australian rock and roll. One name, one legend. Barnsley. For a generation, Jimmy Barnes has remained the undisputed king of Oz rock. In July, Barnsley's new album, Double Happiness, shot straight to the top of the ARIA charts. 21 years on from the start of a remarkable solo career, 21 years since Barnsley's first solo album went straight to number one. 8 number one albums so far. You can't get much happier than that.
Australian rock and roll royalty, that's what Barnsley is.
Before Barnsley went solo, there was Cole Chisel.
Sat in a car when I was about 13 or 14,
yeah.
And All Right Now by Free, and then Black Knight by Deep Purple came on back to back on the radio, and I went, that's it, I'm getting a band, you know.
My younger brother said to me that there was this band called Cold Chisel that was really good. They had this young kid out the front that was just had this most awesome voice.
They produced 5 classic studio albums and played thousands of shows across the country.
Towards the end of Cold Chisel, we all had the feeling in the back of our heads that, you know, that things had hit the top and were starting to slide down.
But at the end of 83, Cold Chisel were gone. Jimmy went solo. He had a new manager and a new record label.
Phil and I were on our first plane up to Bowral, and from that first night, he decided that he wasn't going to muck around, and we had a solo album out, and it was number one within 12 months.
Jimmy followed this with another 5 chart-topping albums in a row. Meanwhile, behind the scenes, there was another side to the rock star, Jimmy the Family Man.
It's great being married to Jimmy. I mean, not because he's Jimmy Barnes, a great rock singer or anything like that, but just for who he is. It was a very natural thing for the kids to be raised in a musical environment.
It was pretty unusual touring with him when we were kids and stuff. I mean, from the time I was born, I've been sleeping at the side of stage in road cases and stuff, you know.
The 90s arrived and the hits kept coming.
Gotcha!
Barnsley shocked his fans and released an album of soul covers. It would go on to become one of the biggest selling Australian albums of all time, and collaborations galore followed.
His love and true affection for all the other types of genres of music is what makes him so interesting and colourful.
It was also time for Barnsley to deal with some of his demons.
Prior to 4 years ago, I don't think you could count the amount of gigs I did sober or straight on one hand.
Deep down, he's probably been really proud of himself dealing with his addiction, and despite all the triggers and everything, but it's the life of rock and roll.
You know, I feel really lucky to have come out the other end of it with, you know, with my sanity intact.
The one thing that I always knew would happen was that there was no way known Jimmy Barnes wasn't going to go number one again.
Barnsley was back with this year's platinum release of Double Happiness.
Getting the opportunity to work with all my kids on this last record is probably one of the best things I've ever done.
Since he's been straight and everything, his voice is just getting stronger and stronger and stronger.
He's one of the greatest rock singers of the 21st century, without a doubt.
He's very pure. He's, you know, what you see is what you get with Jimmy.
He's just absolute music royalty to me. I don't know anybody who deserves what he's getting to do more than what he does for me.
Ladies and gentlemen, please be upstanding, charge your glasses, and join me in welcoming Mr. Jimmy Barnes to the ARIA Hall of Fame.
Thank you so much. And now I promise you I will try not to bore you too much with the speeches, but there's a, you know, I've been singing for about 33 years now, and there's a lot of people I'd like to thank. You know, I'd like to thank my mum and dad for giving me passion, giving me love, you know, that gave me incredible genes, otherwise I'd have been dead about 15 years ago, I reckon. So, you know, I've got a lot to thank them for. I'd like to thank all my family, my brothers and sisters are just awesome, great to grow up with. Particularly my older brother, John Swanee, who, when I grew up, John was amazing. You know, John had, joined a band, ran away from home when he was 13 and joined a rock and roll band, which was great because I got his room and also got his drum kit. So John from day one was my hero. He was my my hero in every possible way. And to this very day, you know, John Swan is my hero. So, you know, I owe a lot to John. So, I'll try and keep it going. I was lucky enough when I was about 16 to team up with a bunch of guys who became brothers to me, the boys in Cold Chisel. And when I think about Cold Chisel, I just think about, you know, incredible times. We shared everything, including our dates. We had incredible times together. We tore this country down, I'm telling you. We played to everybody, everybody we could. We'd do 8 gigs a week. There was an extra member of Cold Chisel, Rod Willis, who was very responsible. I'd like to thank him. And we managed to bluff WEA into signing us in about 1976. And we ended up having an incredible relationship with Warners. And I'd love to thank them for all their support and getting us started, letting us do what we wanted, and letting us run with it. Thank you, smooth talker. I'd also like to thank John Anderson and everybody at EMI for, you know, looking after my publishing, doing all that. There was a bit of a gap in the management there. It went sort of from Rod Willis to Michael Gudinski. But there was a gap in the middle. Michael was my mate. I'll tell you about him in a minute. There was a gap in the middle where I was looked after by a really dear, close friend of mine who was a tour manager for Cold Chisel for a long time, Mark Pope. And Popey's a man of vision and a man of passion. And, you know, he almost talked me into becoming a Parramatta supporter. That's how good he is. Not quite. And Richard McDonald was his partner. And an incredible musician, probably one of the greatest musicians I've ever had the honor of working with. He's a dear friend. Mark Lazotte, you probably know him better as Diesel. Yeah. My current band, you know, Danny, Warren, Dario, Christian, Jackie, my son, Clayton and Lockie, who both all play keyboards with me, Tim Gaze, David Leslie, who's played guitar, they're all awesome. I'd also like to thank a few people who helped out along the way as well. Ian Smith. Smitty was a great guy who toured with me and Diesel and sort of used to, you know, look after us and, you know, take us to hospital and get our stomach pumped and stuff like that when we needed to. Lovely fella. Chuggy, who's, if Chuggy was up here, he'd say, you with the big tits, you know, get over here, I'll meet you later. I love Chuggy, he's a man of passion as well, and you know, it's been sticking up for us for years. I'd also like to take the opportunity to thank Sam Neill, who flew over. Sam's one of my dear, dear friends, and he flew over from New Zealand, especially just to be here because, you know, he's my mate. And I'm very, very proud to have Sam here. Michael Gudinski. Now, I want to talk to you about Michael. Michael is a guy who, you know, I've been with a lot of record companies around the world, and you know, I've been treated really well by them. But the thing that I love about Michael Gudinski, when I first met Michael, was his passion, his commitment to Australian music. And it's very easy for a lot of people to sit there and say, here, I work for a corporation, take my money. Michael Gudinski puts his money from his pocket towards the acts that he supports, and for that I take my hat off to him. Him and his family, Sue and Michael, have been incredible friends. Michael's a godfather to my eldest daughter. His family have just supported us and helped us through every step of our career, and I'm so honored that Double Happiness went number one for him, because I just really wanted to do it for Michael. I'd like to also thank Darren and Dennis Dowlett, who helped me make the album. Unfortunately for all of us, you probably know them better, Disco Montego, you know, Kalen. Darren died a while back, and Darren, it was such a loss. It was such a beautiful, dear person and a great friend, and I dedicate Double Happiness to Darren. And I've left the best to last. I remember in about November 1979 in Canberra, I walked into a room. I was on tour, doing a tour called Pooled Resources with the Angels and a bunch of other bands. And I walked into this room, and I saw an angel. It was the most beautiful girl I've ever seen in my life. She took my breath away. To this day, she takes my breath away. I walked in the red carpet with her, and everybody was taking photos of her, not me. But you know, hey, that's what you get for marrying such a gorgeous girl. She's my heart. She's my soul. I couldn't live without her. My beautiful wife, Jane. And I love you dearly. And I'd also really, really like to thank my kids. My kids have been, you know, I got to tell you, you know, I reckon in my heyday, I probably destroyed half of Bolivia. And I really like to thank my kids for not divorcing me and putting up with me. You know, they're over here. I love them all dearly. They help me with Double Happiness. They all feature on Double Happiness. Hopefully they're all going to tear off into their own careers so that I can sort of kick back and sort of and plan how I'm going to try and get a third aria for, you know, Hall of Fame. And I'd also like to thank everybody in the industry, and especially all the punters here, because I've got to tell you, the best years of my life have been spent rocking in Australia, rock and roll in Australia, anywhere.
Later, a very special performance by Jimmy Barnes, and coming up next, Missy Higgins and the Aria Rock Quiz.